Amen. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, we'd ask you to turn to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 35. Isaiah chapter 35, and we'll begin reading in the very first verse. Isaiah 35, in the first verse, the Bible says, "The wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice even with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given unto it, the excellency of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord and the excellency of our God. Strengthen, you weak hands, and confirm the feeble knees. Say to them that are of a fearful heart, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, even God with a recompense. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap as a hart, and the tongue of the dumb shall sing, for the wilderness shall walk. For in the wilderness shall waters break out, and streams in the desert. And the parched ground shall become pool, and the thirsty in the springs of water. In the habitation of dragons, where each lay shall be grass and reeds and rushes. And a highway shall be there, and a way, and it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for those, the wayfaring men, though fools, shall not err therein. No lion shall be there, nor any ravenous beast shall go up thereon. It shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there. Amen. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy, with their heads, with joy upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away." I'd like to preach, "The Lord be my helper," this morning on the thought, walking in the King's highway. Dear Lord, we thank you for those that are here this morning. Lord, we praise you for that. Lord, we pray that you might show up and that you would honor your word as you promised to do. Lord, we pray those that are lost, that you stir them up to liveliness this morning, that you would impart to them salvation according to your mercy and grace. Lord, those of us that are here, at times we get discouraged and we get lonely. Lord, we pray that you would encourage us today with your word. We'd be faithful to praise you for it, for it's in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Now, number of things here. First of all, I will say before we get started, on the general, most of us do not walk in the King's Highway. Most of us, unfortunately, wander in the wilderness. That was Israel's problem, preferring the wilderness over Zion. Preferring wilderness and bramble over the fat of the land. And that seems stupid. But spiritually, many times, that's the same thing that we do. We prefer the meager over the abundant. We prefer the little shims that we can get over the feast at the master's table. And why do we do that? Why would that be a preference? Well, because we're still flesh. And we always are looking for excuse that we can't be happy. First of all, I want you to see a warning concerning the wilderness. The wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them. Now, in the wilderness, obviously, number one, it's very difficult to see where you're going, and it's very hard to find the end goal. Now, it says the wilderness and the solitary place. If you ever arrive at a real wilderness in your life, I'd be willing to say, you'll be there alone. Now, you can have someone on your elbow and be in a solitary place. You know what I mean? Just because they're there doesn't mean you're connecting with them and doesn't mean that they're a help to you. And it may not even be their fault. They're not deliberately ignoring you, but they're just not what you need right now. So when you think of your solitary place, don't think about people around you, but think about a spiritual solitary place where you're there alone, spiritually speaking, and no one else seemingly having an understanding or even a hint of what's going on with you. The wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them. Now the glad, soul gladness, inward gladness for God's people. The wilderness shall begin to rejoice. In the second part of that verse, the Bible says, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as a rose. Now when you're in this place, if you depend on the Lord, it shall blossom. Now, we live in a very difficult day today, and I understand that, but there is no reason whatever that we can't blossom as flowers. We belong to the Lord. He is our King. And the Bible says, I am the Lord, I change not. So, if Israel could blossom in the desert, why can't we? Yes, it's a hard time to live. Yes, our nation is just about gone. Yes, sin reigns supreme. But have you ever thought about this? It has always been that way.
Amen. That's right.
It has always been that way. That's no excuse. The Bible says itself that Satan is the prince of the power of the air. So he's ruled that, and when he was cast out of heaven and landed in this place called earth, it was his. It belonged to him. Well, it didn't belong to him, but he destroyed it. And that's his goal. He's a destroyer. So every day that you get up and you have the woebegones and, oh, what's going to happen today, and all that that goes with it, you are giving Satan the victory. You are giving him what he delights in. Because if you're really redeemed, if you're genuinely born again, he knows he cannot touch you. But he can sift you. He can bring you down. And you know, this is it. He knows that too. He knows that by his experience with Job. He knows that by his experience with Peter. He knows that he can work you over and that he can make you die in the desert. You can bloom in the desert or you can die in the desert this morning. It's what you determine to do. Two, it, meaning Israel, shall blossom abundantly and rejoice even with joy. Listen, in the desert, you can rejoice. Praise the Lord, I'm a saved man and I'm on my way to glory. I'm not there yet, but I'm saved. You know, the Bible says I have placed some in the church. He didn't place everybody in the church. He saved some that he didn't place in his church. But I'm in his church, so I'm saved. I'm in his church. I'm going to glory. What more could I possibly want? What could this world offer me better than that? Why do I let Satan get me down? And I do, and you do, and we all do. And I tell you this, our eyes are not on Jesus. Our eyes are not on eternity. The allurements of this world have pulled us away. And even the catastrophes in the earth. You know, we think about, you know, red Corvettes and nice trucks. You know, it don't have to be that way. Have you ever seen anybody that just wallows around and loves being miserable? I have. Just, you know, the more devastating news they get, the happier they are. And you know, that's just as much as allurement as the good things in life. Some people thrive on being sad. It ought not to be. Some people just love to be as low as they can get. That ought not to be. And so we find Israel here, and us too, in modern day church, in the days which we live, the church age, that we can blossom. It shall blossom abundantly, rejoice even with joy. Now, a lot of people don't really understand that word rejoice, but it's kind of like a recoil on a gun. If you don't ever shoot it, there's no recoil to it. And so if you don't ever sow any joy and you don't ever receive any joy, you certainly can't give it back. But you know what? Blessed be the name of the God, of the Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. He saved our soul, and that ought to bring great joy. And when He brings great joy, we're going to rejoice right back. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He saved my never-dying soul, and I'm going home to be with Him. That's the recoil. You don't see much of that anymore. I don't understand it completely. At one time, I blamed it on the last days. I won't do that anymore. Because God's people have never been on top. Nor will they be in this life. They have never been on top. They've never been the ones that were selected. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice even with joy and singing. Sing unto the Lord. Give Him praise. We want to be joyful in our singing. Glad. And you may be like me and you can't sing good, but we ought to be glad in our singing, giving the Lord the praise. The glory of Lebanon, which is Israel, the glory of Lebanon shall be given unto it. Now, let me say, And the glory of Lebanon, but do you remember, it was the cedars that they brought into the temple. There was a ruler that gave David the cedars of Lebanon when preparing the temple. Set it aside, ready the day for Solomon to build it. That was going to be now in Israel. He said, I'll give the glory of Lebanon to Israel. You know what? If it be the mind of God, He can sprout up cedars in the Sahara Desert. And you know why? Because He's God. The things that we see as the laws of agriculture mean nothing to God. He can do what He will with what He will. And so He says, I'm going to take these rich treasures of Lebanon, they're beautiful cedars, and they're yours. They belong to you. The excellency of Carmel and Sharon shall see the glory of the Lord. Now, I do want, if you write in your Bible, just underline that. It says that they shall see the glory of the Lord. Now, what or who is the glory of the Lord? It is Christ. He is the glory of God. The Bible says, Jesus is the glory of God, man is the glory of Jesus, and women are the glory of man, and the woman's hair is her glory. Right? I've preached that for years. I hope that slipped your mind. And so we see then, in looking forward, they were going to see who Christ was. They were going to see the glory of God. That's the glory of God. It's Christ, His Son. And they were to look forward to that. You know what? This morning, we are going to see Christ. That is the glory of God. One day, I don't know what it is, when it will be. I may be pushing up daisies next door. That's okay. One day, I will see Christ. You know what? What a wonderful thing. What did Stephen say as he was dying? He looked up to heaven and said, behold, I see Jesus standing at the right hand. And see, he seen the glory of God, did he not? He seen Him. We will too. It may be, I may go the natural way of man, I don't know, but I'll see Christ in that. And it may be that I'll be in the great catching away that will come later, and that way I will see Christ too. Well, what a wonderful thing. You know what? What could get us down and what could get us discouraged if we focus on the time that we will see Christ? And I'll say this. Every time we're pulled away It's of the devil. Right?
Yeah.
Every time we're pulled away and we get our Debbie Downer spirit and get our Debbie Downer clothes on, it's always because we're pulled away from centering on Christ. Notice what it says, they shall see the glory of the Lord and the excellency of our God. Now, every day as we travel about and we go from place to place, we do not see how excellent our God is, and if we did, we would worship Him more. He is an excellent, magnificent God. You know why we're able to breathe this morning? It's because God set it in order. You know why we're in this place this morning? Because God is merciful and kind and good, and He brought us here. That's the excellency of God. You know what? One day, when the great catching away comes, you know why that will come? It's because of the excellency of God. He is excellent. He deserves our praise. In every way and in everything, He is all excellent. He warrants our praise this morning. And we sit back like we're fixing to fall off into the fires of hell. Listen, if you're saved this morning, you're not. And the reason you're not is because of the goodness of God. So with that knowledge, Isaiah says, strengthen ye the weak hands. Now, I don't believe it means these. Bible says the church is fitly joined together. We're a body. There's a head. There's a foot. There's an arm. There's a hand. And if you have one weak part, it don't work like it should. Right? And the Lord's advice was, if thy eye offend thee, pluck it out. But here we find Isaiah, and I'm not saying the Lord was wrong. Listen, if it doesn't get no better, get rid of it. But here He says, strengthen it up. You come by and you see somebody struggling along and say, listen, Christ is our Redeemer. You say you've been saved. You are on your way to glory. What more encouragement could you give somebody? You know what? Sometimes approaching somebody that has a terminal illness, you think, oh, what am I going to say? There's nothing to say. Yes, there is something to say. It is always, always an excellent thing to go home to be with the Lord. It is an excellent and wonderful thing. We should not be discouraged today. And, you know, the way we present sometimes, why would our life be attractive to anybody else if all we ever do is molly grub? Saying to them that are strengthen the weak hands and confirm the feeble knees. Now, you know what a confirmation is? Most people don't even know this. Why do you say amen in a service? That literally means, I agree. I confirm that. You're right. I'm right on with it. Amen. Confirm them. Say, yes, you're right. And listen, when they're feeble mind, feeble need, and they're down there, and you say, listen, get back up. This thing is almost over. We're going home to be with the Lord. Get up. Let's fight one more day. And that is confirming them. That is saying, listen, the new saying is, I've been there and done that. Get up and go. Come on, let's fight one more day. You gotta encourage them. You gotta bring them along and say, get up and let's go. Say to them that are of a fearful heart, be strong. Now, fear will cripple you. Fear will stop everything that you do in the cause of Christ. Now, we can say a lot of things today, and I understand some of them to some point. And we live in a different society than many. A lot of people say, well, if you get out there and street preach, that's just not our culture, that's just not our structure. Well, you know what? I believed that for years, but when I got out there, what I found is the majority of the people want it, and they're glad to hear it, and they're encouraged by it. But the problem
problem is we believe the other way too long. You know what? People lie. What I found from 48 years on this earth is people lie. People, and listen, God's people, they want to bring them down anyway, so if they can sell you a bill of goods and say, listen, nobody don't want to hear it anymore, they'll do that. Don't be afraid to give God the praise. You know why we don't hear more shouting in Baptist churches anymore? It's because people are fearful. If a man says, amen, if a man says, glory to God, then people go, well, you know what? They're acting Pentecostal down in the New Testament. You'd be wary of them. Right? Is that not true? Sure it is. And so we as the Lord's people, we need to be the one that's strong. We need to encourage them. The second part, fear not. I love that song. Fear not, I am with thee. Oh, be not dismayed, for I am thy God. You know, fear will cripple you down to nothing. Why don't you get out and do that? Well, I'm afraid. Well, all I can say, as long as you live there, you will be afraid. And what I have found, nothing makes the devils of hell any more angry than we just get out there and say, my God is God. He is strong and He is merciful and He is good, and I will testify of His name. Listen, all the imps of hell hate. Are you going to have a good day every day? No, I'll tell you what. If you get to this point where Isaiah was pushing Israel, in fact, they're going to be double strong on you because they want to shut you up. Be strong. Fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance. Now, when is that day of vengeance coming? First of all, I say that he's referring to the catching away of God's people, because the day of vengeance comes after we're gone. After we're not here anymore. But you know what? When you see this place falling apart around us, when you see sodomites coming into our churches and demanding recognitions and marriage, when you see that coming, you remember this: vengeance belongs to God. Oh, that's a great encouragement to me. You know, one day they're not going to be on top. One day they're not going to be just top dog, but they'll be brought down pitifully low. And we ought to take great encouragement of that. Listen, God is still God. He is over all these little things here, and they will not last forever. He will pound it out because He's God. Because he can, and his own righteousness causes him to hate the very thought of sin. Say unto them that are fearful, your God will come with vengeance, even God with a recompense. He will come and save you. Now, what you see, it says that again, it's that recall word. He will come with a recompense, with a payment. So all them that said, there is no God, listen, there is a payment coming. There is a recompense, a recall coming from that statement. Right. Madam Marilyn O'Hare, you know what? She has a very special place in hell. She will receive a recompense. And you say, oh, Brother Lafferty, you're judging. No, I'm telling you the truth. I know, listen, there are degrees of hell. I fully believe that. There, you know what? There's a special place for Judas Iscariot. Sure there is. There's a special place for the judges that sat on the Supreme Court and validated Roe versus Wade. There's a special place for them. See, and when all this takes over, and listen, it is, remember, our God is in control. Don't get the humdrummies. Don't say, oh, what's going to happen next? I know what's going to happen next. Our God will define Himself as a sovereign king. That's what's going to happen next. That will be the next piece to the puzzle, is He will reign supremely. That's what's happening next. Then He says, Even God will recompense. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. You know, what he's referring to, really, it's twofold. Number one, you know what? Everyone will one day bow down and say, yes, you are holy. You are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Before Madeline Marilyn O'Hare is cast into the farthest part of the hell, she'll kneel before God the Mighty and say, yes, you are God. Yes, I made a mistake. Yes, it was a horrible thing to do. And then she'll be cast alive into hell. That's coming. They will acknowledge exactly what they did and where they went wrong. I'll give you a little aside, and I really didn't mean to beat up, although she deserves it, Marilyn O'Hara this morning. But you know, she had one son that went right after the role that she did. They both disappeared and no one ever heard of them again. But did you know she had another son that was an independent Baptist preacher? See, if that ain't God, what is? One of the sons just acknowledging who and what God is, and the other one a blasphemer, and you see how it worked out with them. The eyes of the blind shall be opened. Some people say this is the new church, the modern day ever, the modern day people, but listen, I feel that yes, we are open to the things of Christ by God's mercy. But I will also say this. The Bible says every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that He is Lord. It's coming. What a wonderful thing. When you're down and discouraged, know that person on the workplace that pushes you down because of your faith, just know in the back of your mind, one day you're going to acknowledge. One day you're going to acknowledge that God is the very God that He revealed Himself to me as. One day you will see that it's coming. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap as a hart. Now that word hart means deer. Just like the deers that we see all around us. And man, they can leap when they want to, can't they? They can clear fences, they can get going. Can you imagine a little lame person getting up and saying, "Woo! Glory to God!" That's going to happen. In fact, I think it did happen in the temple in the days of the ministry of Christ, did it not? The blind saw again. Remember that fellow said, I don't know if he's good or bad, but this one thing I do know, I was blind, and now I see.
Yep, amen.
That's one thing I know. It happened. Now the problem is, today we minimize the power of God that He can no longer do those things. Don't buy into it. Don't get into that. You know what? God has the power to open blinded eyes. God has the power to say to cancers, be gone. And it's gone in a moment. Things look bleak for Sister Nalan Katrine. But you know what? One word from the Master, it's gone. It's done. And she'll rise and walk again. And so we see that He was predicting a time of great joy and great victory, which we should live in today. For in the wilderness shall waters break out and streams in the desert. And so He's saying, listen, church, listen, people, you're going to have a place to get a hearty drink out there in the desert. You're going to have a place to sup up good cold water. You know what the miraculous thing with the striking of the rock was? Is water came out of nothing. You know what this church is? Really, it's nothing. But God can smite it and greatly rejoice and can run out of it. You know what? And when it does, we need to be just like the soldiers in the days of Gideon, just slap it up. Get there and get all we can. But many times we don't. You know what a lot of people drink? They drink and the thirst goes away. And then they get a mile down the road and they're thirsty again. You need to lap up everything that you can get. Best spring water I know of in Stewart County is down close to Cumberland City in Spout Spring. There's a spring comes out of the side of the hill, and in more years ago than anybody else knows, they shoved a pipe in the side of the hill and just pours out continually, on and on, just as cold as if it came out of the refrigerator. Sweet and good. You know why that's there? It's to declare that I am God. And all the years, even in the roughest droughts I've ever seen, I've never seen it stop. And you know why? Because it's God. And that's what we have to take advantage of if we will. Verse 7. And the parched ground shall become a pool, and the thirsty land springs of water. In other words, I'm going to bring it, I'm going to cause sand to be a pool. I'm going to call that cracked, dry ground. Just because I can, it's going to be a pool. In the habitation of dragons. Now, a lot of people want, oh, that's figurative. You know what I think it is? I think it's dragons. You say, you mean to tell me you think there's dragons? Sure there are. Did they survive the flood? They must have, because Isaiah knew about them. Right? Did they breathe out fire? Well, the Bible says they do. Could they be a type of dinosaur? I suppose. But you know what? I believe it. Do you know? You know, when you start figuralizing or spiritualizing one word, you're on a very, very slippery slope. And it's a quick trip down the hill. And so we see there, as Isaiah is writing to them, he says, in the habitation of dragons, where each lay shall be grass with reeds and rushes. Now, I think what he was saying, if you think about how much it would take to maintain a dragon, in Eden, he says, where their habitation is, where it's desolate, where they've chomped up everything there is, it's going to be bounding. And you know what? I believe there's a lot of spiritual dragons today just snuffing up everything. God, you know, just trying to bring, you know, pull everything out of us that they possibly can. You know what? We have an abundant supply of food. We have, listen, that blessed King James Bible, it talks to me new every day. I've read the same scriptures, and the Lord revealed two totally different things. It's a life. I mean, it will never end. You can read it 1,000 times, and it will still speak life to you because the Bible says it's a living word, and living things respond and look. And so he says those will be there. And a highway shall be there. Now again, we're talking about when we're gaining victory. We're talking about when we're living in victory, right? And in that spot, a highway should be there. Now what I have to believe is this. If you're not living in victory, the highway's not there. If you're living in the wilderness, and more than that, if you're satisfied of living in the wilderness, just the meek and the beggarly, the highway is not there. The highway is going to be the victory. That make sense? Do you live in victory? Do you want to leave the wilderness? Do you want to get out of that, or are you just satisfied? You know, he'll shut up eventually and we'll get to go downstairs and eat a big meal. Where do you want to live? You know what? I think a lot of people are very, very satisfied. You know why you don't see people weep? Because they're living in the desert. You know why you don't see people shout? Because they're living in a desert. You know why you don't see people confess sin? They're living in a desert. And I'll go even further than that. They're very satisfied there. Very, you know, okay, this is how it's going to be. And And a highway shall be there, and a way, and it shall be called the Way of Holiness. Now, those of you, if there are any here that want to give lip service to the King, you're not in the way of holiness. You study the Bible carefully, and there is a way of holiness. Come out from among them and be ye separate, and touch not the unclean thing. Set no evil thing before thine eye. There is a way of holiness. A woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man. There is a way of holiness. It is a shame for a man to have long hair. There is a way of holiness. Right? So we're going to walk there, or we're going to... That is the highway. It is a place called holiness. You know why our churches have no power today? You know why we can look back in history and read of miraculous revivals in the times past? Listen, you follow it in the Bible, and you follow those stories of revivals that happened 200 years ago, and it always started with people weeping. Just brokenhearted or something. That's how it starts. And we need to see more of that today. We need to see more people down and brokenhearted over occurrences in their life. And the highway shall be there in a way which shall be called the Way of Holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for those, the wayfaring man, though fools shall not be therein. So we find two people, two types of people that won't be in it. Number one, the unclean, the lost, the sinful. They're not going to be on the highway. And the other ones, the fools. One thing we know about fools, the Bible says, the fool hath said in his heart that there is no God. They're not going to be there. And you know what? When we come down to the house of God, we need to have our minds on the things of God. Foolishness and jesting, we need to have our mind on the things of God. A true fool is someone that all they're focused on is to make people laugh. That's their whole purpose. You know what? I don't care if people laugh or not. I really don't. And so we find that those two are not going to be in the way. They're not going to be on the highway. Verse 9 says, no lion shall be there, no threat, no one to cause harm, no one to cause threatenings, no lion shall be there, nor any ravenous beast shall go up thereon. Go up thereon, meaning on the highway. Now I will say this, they're present in the wilderness. They're not on the highway, but the ravenous beast and the lion are all out there in the world, and they dearly, dearly love to devour you. Think about the young prophet. And you remember the Lord said unto him, you go straight through, you tell them of the message, and you keep going. Leave a different way. Oh, it's a great message to you. Too many people come and they don't leave different. They leave just the way they got here. But, you know, we had that subtle man to come in and say, I too am a prophet. And you know what killed him? A lion. And in fact, the lion didn't even eat it. Just sat beside him. You know what? That's why lions usually devour something. Yeah. But you know what? If the devil has set his mark on you, he'll take you down and he'll walk off and leave you. He's very good at it. That is one of his many methods, is to leave you cold and empty. It shall not be found there, but the redeemed the born again, the bought back, but the redeemed shall walk there, and the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy upon their heart. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Now, obviously, all that's Israel. Well, do you know where the new kingdom is going to be? It's going to be where Israel is today. The Bible says they saw it coming down from God out of heaven. Where were they at when they said that? They were in Israel. Because the Bible says the Lord will rule from the throne of David with a rod of iron. Where do you think he's going to rule from? He's going to rule from the very seat of Israel. And then the Bible says the new Jerusalem is coming down. And it will be there. So we will be there too. We will be giving him praise. We'll be giving him glory. We'll be giving him honor. Throughout the ceaseless ages. So my question to you this morning is, which way are you living today? And I understand and know one day is one way and one day is another. And the reason for that is the flesh. But don't you ever blame it on God. The reason lies with us. And so which one are you at? Are you one of those dumbfounded sheep out in the wilderness? Or today, are you living in victory? I praise God, and I can give him glory and praise and honor, and for a brief spot be in victory where he would have him. He wants him on the King's Highway. But more times than that.